few years ago, as I was locking up the church at my former parish, I heard a young woman quietly sobbing. She was seated in the front pew with her father. I'm guessing she was about 21 years old. So I went over and I asked her if there was anything I could do to help. She explained to me, as the tears were running down her cheeks, that her leg was broken in three places. Held together with pins, she was in extreme agony. She gave me the impression that she used to have an addiction to opioids, and so she couldn't take anything to help her ease the pain. So then she began to ask me many questions, including, why did God punish me in this way? In other words, she felt completely abandoned by God. And so this leads us to ask, does the resurrection of Jesus Christ make a difference? There is still violence, poverty, and suffering in our world. And so as I listen to her, in a sense, wrestle with God and bring these questions to him, she realized that God was not the cause of her pain. Actually, quite the opposite. She realized that God was both present and consoling her in her suffering. Just as an example, at one point I asked her, well, why did you come to this empty church just to sit in silence? And she said that it was the only place where she felt some relief, the only place that gave her peace. But she really had no idea why. So as she sat gazing at the tabernacle in the center of our sanctuary, I pointed to it and I asked her, do you know what that is? She didn't. So I did my best to explain to her who was in the tabernacle, the person of Jesus Christ, body, blood, soul, and divinity, under the appearance of bread. And as we talked, an amazing transformation occurred in her. She became totally calm and relaxed, at peace. And at least for those brief moments, her pain just seemed to fade away. It was clear evidence to me that God has changed all things in Christ, that we are living in a resurrected time where Christ is truly present and living in our midst. Similar to St. Thomas, through God's mercy, this young woman recognized the divine in her life. And also similar to St. Thomas, she didn't discover this alone, but rather in the community of the church that Jesus Christ has established. You know, I've always wondered why St. Thomas wasn't there that day when Jesus first appeared, why he wasn't there with his friends who were huddled and afraid, locked behind doors. Perhaps he wasn't afraid, or maybe he had lost all hope and abandoned the community. Whatever the reason, and we don't know, but it's interesting that Jesus chose not to visit St. Thomas by himself, but rather he waited until he rejoined the community. Jesus, through his sorrowful passion and glorious resurrection, first reconciled the apostles to himself. He showed them the marks in his hands and his side, and he tells them, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. And then immediately he breathes on them. He gives them the gift of the Holy Spirit. He says, if you forgive sins, they are forgiven. If you retain, they are retained. Jesus entrusted them with the forgiveness of sins, and he thus poured a wave of mercy over all of humanity. And it wasn't until St. Thomas was reconciled to the community that St. Thomas himself declared with great joy, my Lord and my God. It wasn't until then that he felt the peace and joy that can only come from our Lord. This is the same peace and joy that we're invited to experience through the beautiful sacrament of reconciliation, a clear sign, a clear gift of God's merciful love, and also a path to help us find our way home. With recognition of God's everlasting mercy, the Church has designated the second Sunday of Easter today as Divine Mercy Sunday, instituted by Pope St. John Paul II on April 30th in 2000. The solemnity is most closely associated with St. Faustina, who received private revelations from our Lord. And of course, most famous is this beautiful image of the water and blood flowing from our Lord's Sacred Heart that was given to St. Faustina from Christ. In her diary, she wrote down what Jesus had told her. And so at one point, Jesus said to her that humanity will not find peace until it turns trustfully to divine mercy. And so we are all encouraged to pray, Jesus, I trust in you. Well, after receiving the gifts of the Holy Spirit, those apostles, those men who once hid behind locked doors, bore witness with great zeal to the resurrection. And we are inheritors of that witness. Through the water that flowed from Jesus' side on the cross, we have also received the gift of faith through baptism in the Holy Spirit. We believe as St. Thomas believed. Through the blood that flowed from his side, we recall the sacrifice that he made for us, his great love for us, and the mystery of the Most Holy Eucharist. Well, I never saw that young woman again that I met in church a few years ago, that a young woman who had so many questions and, in a way, so many doubts. But yet, she found peace in the living presence of Jesus Christ. A reminder that even though life is filled with happiness and sorrow, hope and doubt, love and fear, through it all, the divine mercy of Jesus Christ has been poured upon us, indeed upon the whole Church. The Church, a community of believers, of one mind and one heart. We are instruments of God's mercy. And so if there is anyone here today who feels lost, you have been found. If there is anyone here who feels alone, you are loved. And if there is anyone here who is suffering, together we will lift you up. The resurrection has changed everything. And so we turn to Mary, our Mother of Mercy. We pray, help us, dear Mother, to always have trust in your Son, our Redeemer. Help us fix our weak gaze upon your divine Son's face. Oh, please help us. Help us proclaim with one voice, Christ Jesus, I trust in you.